All right. How about Erie Tech? Erie Neighborhood House.
Good evening, I, my name is David Swanson, and this is Julian Rosade. We are from Erie House. Erie House is actually a fairly large social service agency. We're a CBO. We've been around since 1870, quite a while, over 140 years. And workforce and technology is really only a small part of what we do. I was saying to LaShawn before, most of what we do is actually child care, and we do a variety of other services for immigrant communities in particular. But we've had technology programming for decades. I don't know the start date of that, but at least as long as I've been there. And we've always offered our technology classes, digital literacy type stuff, in English and Spanish. We serve a large Spanish-speaking community. And the tech classes in all of our adult programming, it actually serves the greatest number of people. We serve several hundred people per year. I think it's actually, it gets into the thousands. I think we serve nearly 1,000 people a year, if you count the people that actually come through the CTC. We have a community technology center in Westtown, and then also in Little Village. We have a site in the Little Village neighborhood of Chicago on the south side. And right now, although we do, we put a lot of people through our basic and our intermediate and what we call our advanced technology classes, people are very happy with the programs, but they just want to take more classes. And we are looking for ways to translate that into actual economic development or workforce outcomes like job placement and stuff like that. For funding purposes, but also just for the good of the community members, we want to make sure that we're giving them something that they can take somewhere, and we'll open up doors for them in their life. So I was really glad to hear what you guys at Tech Services were saying about trying to strive for standardized goals and metrics across organizations. That's kind of what I would like to find out from this group, how we can agree or at least share what we're doing and what will be the best goals to strive for, so that we can actually deliver to our participants something that's going to be of use to them, not just something that makes them feel good. Although they do feel very good after they take our classes. We do graduations and everything. I don't know, I want to pass the ball to Leon so we can just kind of alternate slides here. But
yeah, well, I mean, I think it's sort of jumping around a bit.
Yeah,
I think that David, obviously did a good job talking about what we're looking to do with specifically to the CTCs, as David mentioned, but I also just wanted to kind of circle back a little bit more towards the larger purpose and goal of the organization, because I think that's really important, and I think it speaks to the fact that the organization has been around since the late 1870s, and has become one of the most well-known community-based organizations in the city, starting out as a settlement house originally. And now, as David mentioned, we have expanded a lot of our organizational time and effort is dedicated towards childcare programs. But through those programs, we did find out that people were looking for more, not just for the actual childcare, but what were the parents up to? What are the parents into? So it was through that sort of a scheme that we figured out that we could provide such programs for parents. And we have lots of community-based organizations as partners as well, one of them being Association House, who we work with a lot, and we hope to continue that moving forward, and we think that we will. And I think David did a great job, so I don't want to repeat myself too much, but in terms of what we need, we wanted to talk about that a little bit, because we are actively looking for some of these partnerships, again, in Tech Services, was talking about in terms of specific, even just software, something as basic as that, but that changes relatively frequently, is important for our participants, and it's important for it's important to ensure that not only are we meeting our own internal goals as an organization, but that we're providing our participants with the necessary skills, you know, so that we're not offering someone office, you know, 2007, but that we can keep that up. And unfortunately, there are situations where there are community-based organizations where you go in and a lot of their equipment, you know, when they're offered these sorts of services, as you say, they sort of have wires everywhere and, you know, fairly outdated equipment. And as a beginning, that is great, but we want to make sure that we are preparing our program participants for what is going on now, for the jobs that are available now, but also for the jobs that we know are coming down the pipeline, especially with the big announcement from the Obama administration recently about workforce development having a hub here in Chicago moving forward. It's exciting for us because we know that we are on the cusp of that as a relatively small community-based organization. But we want to make sure that we are working with our participants as much as possible to provide them with whatever they need to get them to those jobs that we know are here, but the ones that are also coming.
Yeah, I mean, that pretty much says it. Julian and I both represent the Workforce Development Department. There, within that, there's a technology services program, and that is all of the computer classes that we offer within that technology services program. So these needs listed up here are coming from our technology services coordinator. She is the one who's actually in touch with the physical needs of the program. So I see, you know, those are kind of the obvious needs, I would say, of any trainer, and they certainly are our needs. But then there is also the community's need that I want to mention. The community is coming to us, you know, very interested in these computer classes. It's a really easy sell. They know by word of mouth that we have these, and it's not really on people's mind necessarily what can I do with this, you know, we're looking at implementing the A+ certification because that's just, you know, something that we feel might be able to get them some kind of career advancement once they graduate with us. But people coming to us so far have been more likely to start internet cafes, even if they go back to their home countries. You know, that happens a lot. Or people will kind of go off and do small businesses. Of their own. They'll do computer repair, or they'll do kind of side jobs. They'll turn it into a side job. And that's kind of been the extent of our workforce development in the technology services realm. We'd really like to expand that and get into more, show people some pathways into IT, you know, professions. So that's kind of, our vision right now.
Let me pick up on a couple of things you said. First of all, you guys work in the workforce development section of the Erie House mission, and it Greg, it ties in pretty closely to one of your sort of, you know, broad ideas and needs is to more tightly integrate workforce development and computer skills and digital literacy. It's something, Danielle, I know that you think about a lot at the city, and we're all trying to think about as Danielle implement this, the tech plan, the city's tech plan, because there isn't really a real connection. And frankly, there's a lack of connection between the digital. I mean, you guys are a great example of a technology operation inside another organization that does direct human services, but then those direct human services interact with workforce development, things along those lines. I think that the general sphere of workforce development is a little more mature in terms of, you know, funding, in terms of being a discipline in and of itself. And it's something that over the last maybe decade or so has been something that's turned into a real discipline. And I think that's one of our goals around Connect Chicago and just pulling everybody together is to create that discipline. And when I talk about that discipline as a culture of shared learning, we also have an opportunity to blow past old models of direct government funding directly to, you know, to an institution that delivers services. But I mean, I'm very compelled by the idea that people you train go back to a country of origin and start businesses, like internet cafes. That's it. That's what we need here. That's what we need. This is where it's at. We have to get to the point where we understand that all of these things that we're doing are actually enormously valuable in the marketplace, and that there is a marketplace for these activities, whether it's, you know, the provision of computing or the, all the things that you can do on it. I had a specific question about Photoshop. What is your what are your Photoshop classes look like? Right? What is what happened? What's the deal?
As far as Photoshop, that is it begins in our at our intermediate level, and you know, I'm not in charge of that department, so I'm going to give you the best idea that I have of it. But all of our students have to go through the basic digital literacy curriculum. There's no starting halfway, and after they graduate that, the Photoshop is one of the topics. I think it's one of you know, along with the basic office software, the Photoshop is taught from an image processing standpoint related to modifying photographs. We usually have people make like family photograph albums or stuff that they would actually want to do with image processing, and they work on their projects. We've always wanted to have a dedicated server so that we can display people's personal websites that they make, but we haven't actually done that yet. But people do. They work with a photographer, one of our tech promoters, who is himself a graduate of the programs, like all the tech promoters. He's also a professional photographer, and he's someone who comes in with all the lighting equipment and shows people how to, you know, do professional level image processing on their photos. So that's kind of what our Photoshop class is like right now.
Huh.
Yeah.
And you may think about two ideas. So one is that city colleges have this ability to enable any space to be a community classroom. It just has to be designated by the local community college. And so that classroom can then be used for earning credit towards the social degree. So give that some thought about partnering up. And maybe colleges do this too. I just know about the city colleges.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Right, because I was trying to get a space in my community designated as community classroom because we were having people just have problems taking the bus down the street, you know, because of boundaries that we all know about. So give that some thought to help with the next step with some of your clients. And then the second thing is when I was sitting through this presentation of a robotics plant that wanted to relocate in one of the areas we were targeting. One of the presenters says, you know, they're not looking for all that type of education, just do you have the certificate? So with the digital manufacturing lab coming and more things like that, like the group we're talking to, just figure out what the five certificates are that you want to, you know, go to. And and that is a potential source of funding, because she was going through. This is the engineer who knew how to do all the stuff, and she said, and it was a real workforce opportunity. She was modeling it off of, I think, a group out of Ohio that takes folks who are reentering the community for whatever reasons, whether it's mothers reentering the workforce, whether it's people formerly incarcerated reentering, and turning them into folks who can work in this robotics plant. And as long as we could get them to this level of math, I get this certificate, you know, and work on the soft skills, you know, they were great. So, so just figure out what those four certificates are.
So those four certificates?
Well, I have no idea. I'm not a robotics engineer. I have notes somewhere. But all of that type of light manufacturing is coming back. That's why the digital manufacturing lab is here, because it's coming back. And so there's lots of corridors in all of our communities that can be used for that type of local business initiatives and then for the light manufacturing. So that's another area of certification to consider. Now, I don't know what all that takes. I have, you know, like I said, an idea.
No, thank you. Yeah, that's great. I mean, I'm concerned with the manufacturing more. Machining and fabrication, you know, it's a part of the workforce department, but we do want to integrate our technology classes with that too. So
Exactly, that's why I'm, since you that's what made me think about it.
Right.
You mentioned you have tech promoters. Can you talk a little bit about that role, what that role is in your organization?
Sure. I'm going to give it a shot. The tech promoters program is, again, referenced our sort of lead on the IT part at this point within Erie Neighborhood House. Her name is Ed Vox, and she, unfortunately, couldn't be here today, but Ed Vox is great. Her role is essentially she first goes out and recruits, right? So all of us, it's all incoming out, all of us, obviously, Vox had to recruit for our programs, but through that, we find folks that are interested in these sorts of classes that are being offered, particularly our IT, a burgeoning IT bridge. And through that, eventually we get some folks that will go through the cohort, through the program, and then continue on, you know, in some fashion, either within their church or within starting their businesses of any sort. But Edva tends to work with, she starts to work with folks that want to continue on with Erie as volunteers in particular, and she then trains those folks in terms of how to go from being a participant in the group to being a trainer of this new cohort that's coming behind them. So the idea being that it's supposed to be a self-sustaining, sort of self-perpetuating model, you know, and because Ed was only one person, and obviously she can only go so far, so we want to make sure that we have as wide a bridge as possible, but it's also not just wide but deep, with people that are engaged, and they decide their level of engagement. You know, some folks can only be there perhaps once a week, some people really sink their teeth into it, and can be of a little bit more service or provide a little bit more of a service to Erie and to Edva in particular. And then through that, we have the presence of a tech promoter helps Erie in any number of ways, right? Not just particularly within the specific programs that they're working on, but even just coming in and seeing for folks that are interested in Erie to bring perhaps their child there to see that someone is really taking another step forward, not just in terms of receiving a service, but now giving back into that service. The tech promoter program is really, it's a great idea, but it is costly in terms of time because it takes obviously a lot of time to train, to recruit and then train. But the output that we're getting from the perspective of Erie seems to be great, and obviously for the tech promoters themselves is also something that we've heard nothing but good things about this far. You know, it's something that is a skill building pipeline, but it's also even just in terms of more the soft skills, you know, to people who maybe are a little more reticent, but are good with technology, and then they are eventually forced to really deal with folks on a face to face basis in order to get them to a level that hopefully that they are at, if not farther.
Oh yeah. I also wanted to mention that our tech promoters program, which like Leon said, it turns participants who've been taking all of our classes into the people that actually modify the curriculum and run the classes. That's really heavily based in a popular education model. That's something that comes out of Latin America. It's just a model. It's hard for me to explain it, but if you look it up, it's called educación popular. It's popular education is like a way of creating an atmosphere in which all of the students kind of respect each other, and any one of them could become the leader or the teacher of the group at any point. So that's really the model that has supported the tech promoters. Without that philosophy, I don't think it would have been possible for a tech program to actually survive and be self-sustaining and be producing its own teachers and modifying its own curriculum without that underpinning. You know, so popular education. I'm not going to go into it right now, though. It's too much.
Well, that's really interesting too. How long do they tend to stay with you guys? And what kind of outcomes do they have? Have you seen them get new and better jobs? Or
We see people get jobs, but we have people stay with us in the long term. Most people who complete our basic class, if they continue with us after the basic class, they take every single other class that we offer, and they just want to take them all. And that takes a year, it takes a couple of years. And we've had the same group of tech promoters for a long time. There's very little turnover, and we are able to give them a stipend out of the funding that we get.
Yeah.
It's a stipend, it's not much, but it's something.
As far as outcomes, workforce outcomes, we haven't been documenting it. You know, we haven't been accountable for it to our funders. And I don't think that I think that most people who've been staying in our program for a while have a stable situation at home, you know, and they're fine. And I would not say that they've been, you know, we haven't been catapulting them into the IT realm, and they're, you know, that those kind of outcomes haven't been happening. It's been more along the lines of returning home to their country and starting internet cafes, or consulting on the side, making extra money that way, but it's probably under the table anyway, you know, so it's like, we just haven't been documenting that.
What about quality of life outcomes for them too, because there's so much more they can do for other areas of their life once they have these other skills?
Yeah, that's the best part of it. That's, if you walk into our tech lab, that's what you see is just pictures of people's families, and the kind of projects that they do is really kind of geared towards, well, they're the ones that came up with the curriculum. So what you see is people, you see a lot of people's personal lives being involved with the tech classes. That's why they want to use the technology. It's not, you know, it's not that they're trying to accomplish A, B, and C so they can do this, but they just want to enrich their lives through technology. So now, our challenge is to make that compatible with the workforce, with workforce outcomes. So that's what we're really trying to do. But yeah,
we have to build a culture.
Oh, the culture's there. Yeah, I can say. I mean, the program is very strong in terms of the culture that's been developed. But go for the outcomes now.
One tactical question about the Photoshop. Is the goal, so it sounds great, two things. It's sort of like the basis in family photos, the basis in being of use to the people being trained is great. Do you have any course material at all for it? Because that'd be awesome to publish that.
Well, yeah, actually, we do. I mean, the curriculums they're pretty well established, and I'm going to have to ask our coordinator about that, because she's the steward of those documents. But yeah, I can imagine her saying, yeah, she would be happy to, I would imagine her sharing those, that at least what the curriculum consists of, if not the whole thing.
And you guys could put that on your Connect Chicago page, your detail page on Connect Chicago.
Okay, sure.
Because then anybody who's interested in these topics could then grab it.
Okay, sure. And what's your specific interest in the Photoshop?
Well, I'm just drilling down on it because you have it, right? So it's like, in our world, we want to drill down into tools. So there's the big picture, and I think, Greg, you just did a really good job of sort of laying out, like, what's the big picture? What sphere are we in? What, you know, what are the resources we have? And you guys are drilling down. I've heard, like, so that's sort of like a benchmark, almost, you can think of, right? It's like, we should have, you know, a region that construes technology education and stuff in this manner. And then you guys are drilling down into Educación Popular. You know, that's like, that's, I mean, we could talk for 3 days about that, you know?
And
then,
you're going to have to come back and talk.
Yeah. I would love to. I mean, that's
the conversation. Yeah.
And then, also, so on Photoshop, what we're trying to do in Connect Chicago is to lift up great examples and give concrete tools for other people who are less along the line, right? So Erie House is a relatively sophisticated CTC when it comes to these things, right? When it comes to having a philosophy of education, when it comes to, you know, you have long parent experience in teaching Photoshop. And what I would love to see is, and this is why I'm hesitant, I'd love to talk to Elma, is that her?
Elva,
about it. But, you know, it gets sophisticated, because what I was going to suggest is maybe using GIMP, right, which is a free photo editing tool that's available online. But I wouldn't suggest using GIMP if one of the objectives of the instruction is to teach them sophisticated software. You know what I mean? So it's like, but having that discussion is really what matters, more than like, oh, you should do this or you should do that. It's more like, you know, wow, what is your goal? Well, my goal is to like get people to feel really comfortable with a really powerful enterprise-grade piece of software that they can then use to go make, you know, a business. Or if the goal is,
you know, they want to crop out the ant that they can't stand, you know what I mean, so they can put the photo, you know.
Yeah, right. Well, it starts like that, yeah.
it's all on a continuum. Anyway, it's a super, super instructive what you
showed.
Anything else for these guys?
You had some more slides?
Oh, wow, that's it. That's what you need. Oh, what is APL certification? I should know. Is that a thing?
Copies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're looking at doing that. There's a lower level of it. It's called Strata. That's IT fundamentals, just really just the most basic stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and our students, they all pass that exam very easily. But the actual A-plus certification by CompTIA, we're not a testing center. We don't offer that training right now, so we're trying to amp up our capabilities to where we can deliver that certification to the students.
And I think that from a collaboration standpoint, I think those are the types of things that, as we talked about, because there are places that are testing centers, and maybe you want to build that for yourself, or you want to take advantage of the ones that may be near you and so forth. You talk about more advanced equipment for those types of classes, and it may be until you build a volume where those investments make sense. You might partner with someone that's already got that, and then you get people to a certain level. Maybe then they move to a partner that has already those investments. And
that would actually be ideal, I mean, for us,
because that's the big thing. Once you get beyond the desktop, keeping up with that is even harder, because then it becomes even more expensive, and it's not just now the technology, it's also the training materials, and while the popular education is good at a certain level, at some point it's more structured and formalized, and you have to have someone that has done it before, and so forth. So again, from a collaboration standpoint, it might be good, at least in the near term, to be looking for those partners that maybe you have the folks, they have the means, and you share that.
I agree, and we definitely are looking for those kinds of partners. So if any assistance offer me, that would be great. Right now, the only thing we've done as far as transferring people to a training partner for A-plus is Humboldt Park Vocational Center at Wright College over there in Humboldt Park. Mm-hmm. They have that program, and we've been transferring people over there. But their program isn't really fleshed out yet, and we're wondering, hey, should we do it ourselves on-site, or are there other partners we can work with
Again, if we're at the collaboration, talking about collaboration, I probably even challenges to why you can do this, where are you going with it? There's a glut of people that have years and years of experience that people coming out of a program where they have just the A-plus, and I don't mean to minimize it, but if I just have it and none of the experience, now I'm up against those competing in a workforce. Now, I'm not saying this is a bad idea. I'm just saying, what is that outcome going to be? Is it going to be frustration?
Realistic, right.
Right. I've got this, but I can't do anything with it.
Right.
Or is there an outcome that has maybe could be built for them, and so that there's a good transition rate? Maybe it's some outlet of doing the popular education. And now I know more. Maybe I can do more with training people. Or maybe one of the things that we've seen effective is creating a depot for repair, mostly virus, taking care of viruses and stuff. But now then folks can start applying what they've learned and get some experience in working in the community to do technology support for the community. Now you're building up the community as well in their capabilities. Maybe they're putting in, helping put in small wireless networks in a home or other types of taking what they've learned and applying them within the community. They may not be earning much of any dollars, but they're gaining the experience as well.
I think that's the right question, that's the question we're asking ourselves.
Had a phone conversation this morning with the exact title. I think the director for workforce development programs with CompTIA, in Gretchen Cole, which we've had conversations in the past with my predecessor, the person in my position before I did, And she is looking, we're looking to have a sort of a sit down to kind of start to flesh this out a little bit more, because it was initially kind of discussed a few months back, but never really went anywhere, along with the Chicago Workforce Board, you know, to really figure out, right, whether it makes sense for us. But on top of that, as you said, you know, great question, like, what are the aspirations?
Reggie, talk to me about the IT Learning Exchange.
Today was our first conversation on the phone, so she threw a couple of things at me, but that wasn't one of them.
I wanted to add, in regard to Photoshop, there were several outcomes that came to my mind in terms of what people can do with those skills, you know, after they've learned the software. You know, you've got t-shirt businesses, greeting card businesses, stationery, and also promotional products. These are real opportunities for business ownership once they learn how to manipulate that application.
Thank you. So, something, if you were able to integrate that kind of entrepreneurship type education into our program, I mean, I'd be thrilled. I don't know where to begin with that. But
talk to her. Yeah. I mean, the other aspect of it too is the whole other area of computer, you know, graphic design, which is artistic, you know, because many people are no longer just painting with acrylics and watercolor. They're creating their images and their prints on, you know, through digital equipment. So for many younger, perhaps I'll say, artists, you know, this is an avenue that they connect to, because they're so used to the technology, that then they can take those images and print them on a canvas and sell them in these various fairs and festivals, you know, that they have around the city. I have some personal experience with that, because I've, you know, exhibited at a number of festivals, but I've also influenced my son to be a young artist, and he's done it already at age 11. But I'm just saying, this is, you know, you can create art in a matter of, I don't know, every piece is different, you know, 30 minutes to 2 hours, 4 hours, however long it takes. But, you know, once you get a portfolio of work, you know, then you can go, you know, help someone understand how to spell that and
really turn it into a business. Thank you. I mean, that seems to be how it is more in IT, it's more that way than in other industries we work in. Healthcare and manufacturing, you apply for the job, you get the job, or you don't get the job. My friends, people I know who got IT jobs, they kind of, you know, they have to take more initiative, you know, and they have to educate themselves in a number of different, you know, sub-disciplines, and then they go out and fail 3 times, you know, starting up a business or whatever, and they just kind of claw their way into it and find a niche. So thinking about how to actually educate people and show them how to do that is a little intimidating. You know, how do you teach that? You can teach the content, but teaching that type of entrepreneurship is something that I welcome any suggestions on.